Pivot GPA giveaway still going on. Going to be at 100 subscribers. Just make sure you like, you comment, you subscribe, and you turn on that notification bell. And as soon as we hit 100 subscribers, you're going to get a free t-shirt and a hat or some shorts. What it do? What it don't? Welcome to the SEANCAST. Yo, we're going to dive in to some stuff today. I was supposed to have Jonathan on this episode, but due to some weather issues, he lives kind of far, so we decided not to make the drive. We're gonna do it on Sunday, so all of the questions sent to him and sent to me will all answer on Sunday this week, and it'll be out next Thursday. So yeah, man, as far as what's going on in my life, you know, next week I'm gonna talk to Jonathan a lot about what he's got going on. I'll probably take a little bit of a back seat there as much as possible. And yeah, but for me, man, we are happy. Life is good, dude. I finally got some food pulled out of my plan, so I don't feel like a slug all the time, and that's sick. I'm feeling good again. I'm feeling like light on my feet, and every time I don't go to bed, you know, every time I do go to bed, it doesn't sound like I'm going to suffocate, which is sick. And I can actually sleep good again. Everything is just feeling better in general. I've got some clients in prep. Pretty deep into prep. Really not. Through that first initial push, we are looking at 15 weeks out, 16 weeks out, and 17 weeks out right now. For shows, and then possibly, I think, 21 weeks out. So, I'm excited. I'm super excited. We've got quite a few guys doing those shows that I mentioned, and man, those are going to be fun. Keep your eye out. Super talented individuals, and going to be just, everything is rolling smooth right now with all these people, so I'm super excited for every single one of them. I'm excited for them. I'm excited for me. Like, I'm excited to get to go through this process. It's my first peak with three of them. So, you know, the first one in the bag is you do a little bit of guesswork. Like, there's just a little guesswork to be done. You have to, because, hey, man, you don't know what works for their body perfectly yet. And we're going to get there, no doubt. But, you know, that first peak is always maybe. Not to say that we can't hit, like, nail it, because I 100% think we can. It's just like anything else, man. It's game one, you know? And especially in something like bodybuilding, it's so particular. You've got to get every little thing just right. With everyone that, you know, I've got huge compliments on Tilly's look at this last show. Obviously, she got a ton, too, in how great that she looked. That's our second prep together, okay? So we figured out what the first one we did wrong. And the second one, we really got to put it together. You know, a couple of these guys that I'm prepping for this upcoming fall, it's their first shows, but then I've got another guy that's pretty experienced, and then one other guy that's also pretty experienced. And those will probably be a little bit easier because there's probably a little bit less there. We have some, at least, data from the previous preps to know what worked for them at the time, and they know what didn't. So we're going to make the application there happen, and those are going to be super fun. So I couldn't be more excited for, you know, career stuff in general. But for me in particular, I think that, you know, I'm probably nearing a good bit closer to being able to prep myself, which I'm really excited about. You know, I'm hoping that middle of next year sometime we dig into something. I feel like I've been saying that for a few years. But, you know, I'm always fine with taking more time and just getting better. But, yeah, I really think this time around that it's going to be probably sometime next year. And I'm super excited for that. I'm not super excited to be hungry, but I'm excited for how it's going to look. And just getting to, like, go through that process again. It's been, like, 4 years, man. So I'm really looking forward to that with a coach I've been working with for years now. And, you know, our first prep together. So that'll be fun. But yeah, man, life has been wild in a lot of ways lately, and, you know, I kind of came to a conclusion recently that there's always going to be issues, right? Like you're always going to have roadblocks. You're always going to have trouble of some type. There's no such thing as just smooth sailing through life. It's just not how it goes. A lot of this stuff is just how you deal with adversity, you know? What is your response? And it's not how do you avoid it, because you ain't going to avoid it. It's just how do you respond? And a big thing that I noticed in myself recently that maybe I didn't particularly like was that I didn't like my response to adversity in general, which I feel like was kind of rare for me. But this is more so of like applied in my personal life. I feel like I am very, I have a good way of categorizing professional life and bodybuilding and all this stuff. And I can sort through, like, adversity in those situations, I'm much more accustomed to. And I can make those adjustments really easily. Whenever it comes to, like, life, man, you're dealing with people and relationships and family and everything. It's not as easy because there's so many little variables. And there's emotions at play. And there's just so many different things at play. And at one point, I just kind of realized that, like, it's a dangerous game to, like, go down the path of, oh, somebody's got it worse, because you need to be able to, like, take it easy on yourself a little bit, you know, give yourself a little bit of credit. But it's one of those things, man, like, how big of an issue do you want to make out of small things, right? And, you know, how do you respond to those things that, like, you know, for a person like me, I have had my struggles, like, mentally, you know, of just getting down on myself. Like, I can execute probably at a really high level in everything that I'm doing, but emotionally, mentally, I can just be down on myself, and I can start beating myself up pretty quick and just, like, I don't know, rabbit hole the whole situation completely unnecessarily. And dude, I can ruin my own day so quickly. And it's just absolutely unnecessary. At one point, like, I just kind of took a step back. I'm like, dude, it's just not all that bad, is it? Right? Like, yeah, there's things that you don't want to happen. There's things that you don't want to hear. There's things that it's just how it works. That's just how it works. You don't get to have everything you want all the time. So, I mean, at one point you just suck it up. Like, it's going to be fine, you know? Not every little detail along the way is going to be perfect. So, Just shut your mouth. Just, you know, shut your mind up. Don't shut your mouth. Shut your mind up and just fucking deal with it. Like, it's kind of, I don't know. It sounds really simple. Maybe it sounds like, I don't know. I don't want to put anyone down or, like, within their struggles. You know, everyone struggles. And I get you just got to go through it sometimes. But sometimes you also just don't have to go through it. Sometimes you just don't have to go through it. You could just be fine, you know? And, like, some of the things that I hear, you know, there's real problems. There's real problems in life. And I hear some issues that some people have. And I, you know, everyone, you know, their plight is their own. But, like, dang, dog. I feel like such an old head being like, everybody's getting soft. But, man, I look at myself sometimes. I'm like, damn, am I getting soft? Scary. Don't want to get soft, man. Last thing I want to do. Horrifying. I don't want to live like that. You don't want to live unhappy, man. You really control that at the end of the day. You control that. Nobody else. Anything can happen, you know. Other people don't get to control that for you. And, like, don't give them that power. People walking around, fucking all mopey. Hanging your head. Well, you know, so-and-so said this about me, and my stepmom or whatever. You know, fucking whatever, man. Just shut up. It'll be fine. You'll be fine. I don't know. Eat a donut. Drink a coffee. Do something that makes you happy. Chill out. Chill out. You'll be fine. Whatever, man. The point is just chill out. Dang. Everybody be doing the most. Everything's a huge deal. Oh my God. Just relax, man. There's way bigger deals than what people make a big deal out of. You know, if something doesn't affect you, if something doesn't like directly influence your life, it doesn't skew your path in some way, and what you do in your day-to-day life, hey man, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Leave people alone. Let them do what they want to do. Unless they're just absolutely, you know, they're absolutely impeding your path. That's the only justification I have for you being like, you know, this or that person, you know, you gotta handle it. And then you just handle business. Hey, you move on. Okay. Hey, look in the mirror sometimes. Ask yourself if you're getting soft. Might be. If you are, do something about it. And now, I'm not saying I'm not an advocate for taking care of yourself. Take care of yourself. I advocate for healthy, you know, daily processes. Read, write, pray, meditate, go to therapy. Do these things. Like, that doesn't make you soft. You know, if anything else, it's quite the opposite. You choose to handle things in a more mature way, in a more planned out and progressive way. That's strong to do. What's not strong is letting whatever these outside circumstances are in your life affect your mood, the way you operate, you know. That rubs off on other people too, man. You're screwing up other people's energy, not just your own. So figure it out. It's way easier to like do physically tough things, but like being mentally strong, that is a very difficult venture, because most people at some point in their life have plenty of reason to justify being mentally weak in one way or another. Whatever that looks like, just not living with any levels of discipline, submitting to some form of addiction, to throwing yourself into things that you know are, you know, is bad for you, whatever it might be. Just that those levels of mental weakness in general, it's really easy to fall into those patterns. You know, I think about monks sometimes, and these guys that like take vows of silence and stuff, right? Like, I can't imagine that life, because as a person who I believe, I can genuinely look at myself and say, I think I am mentally strong to an extent. I'm not that mentally strong. Like, dang, dog, you ain't gonna talk for the rest of your life? You're not gonna use your voice box? That shit's crazy. But that's the standard, you know? That's like your standard for mental strength. And then the bottom of the barrel is just like how the U.S. population lives today. It's so pitiful. It's so hard to watch. Man. It's crazy, you know? People can't even bring themselves. I say doing physically hard things is the easy part. People can't even bring themselves to do that. People can't bring themselves to go take a walk. You know? Dang. Much less take a walk, and then read a couple pages of a book. I don't know. The fact is, I'm not great at it sometimes either. I'm not saying I'm perfect by any means. You know, there's some... there's always reflection to be done on my side on those things and trying to be better at it. But, man... Ooh. Sometimes I feel like I gotta move, man. I gotta go to, I don't know, New Zealand. someone told me recently in New Zealand, you need like $1,000 in your bank account or something like that. They're like, yeah, come on. Here's a green card for here's a work visa for a year. You can work here for a year. Like, that's wild. That's wild to think. Yo, I don't even know what I'm talking about. I don't even know what I'm talking about. I'm just talking. I started talking about, I don't know, mental strength, and I ended up in New Zealand. Who knows? But anyway, look, the point of what we're going to talk about today is I want to stray from Q&A a little bit, mainly because I forgot to put one up. So what we're going to do is 5 tips that I've compiled for beginning bodybuilders, fitness enthusiasts, people that just want to build muscle, especially that want the look better, feel better thing, right? Which I think is what most people chase in the gym. Most people don't want to be like a power lifter. Some people want to get stronger, but that's just like kind of a niche group. There are bodybuilders, which has definitely grown in popularity in the last, since maybe the birth of these new divisions around 2015-16. It's definitely picked up in popularity. And then outside of that, it's just, there's a lot of like amateur bodybuilding that goes on, you know, guys that will never step on stage, but just like want to look bigger, want to look better. Same with women that just want to look, want bigger muscles, want to look better. These tips are directed for these people who are maybe rookie novice, first year, second year getting into it. Maybe you're just starting. Maybe it's month one. Maybe it's day one. This is for you. The first thing, and to me the most important thing, some people would disagree, but to me the most important thing is training. It's the way you approach your training. It's the biggest part of your entire journey as a bodybuilder, as a amateur bodybuilder, as a fitness enthusiast. If you're trying to build muscle, it's everything. So within the category of training, what is important and what is not? What do you want to focus on as a beginner? And what do you want to stray from? And for you that don't know, I've been training at this point for about 8 years, going on 9. So at this point, I would call myself very experienced. And you know, I coach a lot of bodybuilders and through their training. So early on, don't get so focused in learning RIR and RPE scheming and how many reps in reserve I have, and oh, this set needs to be 2 RIR, and this set needs to be 0, and this set needs to be 6, and I need to rotate, have a rotating intensity schedule. Hey, man, no, you don't. You don't need any of that. All you need is to train hard, okay? Don't get caught up in volume and in intensity scaling, you know, any of really, you can just take the basic principle of progressive overload and just run with it. Train really hard. Ideally, stick to some of the same base movements and progress those lifts. You know, the big caveat here being is that you've got to be lifting with proper technique. Now, that I highly suggest hiring somebody. If you can't, do research, man. There's so much good information out there. Mountain Dog on YouTube, John Meadows, rest in peace. Go watch John Meadows. John Meadows got incredible training stuff out on YouTube. So do research, figure out how to get your mechanics dialed in, and then take that progressive overload approach. And we're talking progressive overload. All I mean is that you take these base movements within your programming and you progress them week to week, month to month, year to year, and you continue to add load and add intensity to these movements. What we usually use is some form of sliding scale. Now, this is getting a little bit more nuanced, but can be extremely helpful for a beginner. Think about a barbell back squat. Say you're squatting 225 and you can do that for 10 reps, and that's all you can do. It's all you have in the tank. do 225 until you can do about 13 reps. And then once you can do 225 for 13 reps, go to 245. Maybe you can only get it for 8, but then work that until you can get that for 13. And then we slide it back down. Weight goes up, slide the reps back down. And it's just like this. That's how you can really progressive overload all of your movements across the board. Outside of all of that, the most important thing is just intensity, man. Be intense. Train to failure. Learn how to train to failure. Give everything you've got. Every bit of effort that you have, give it in there. Nothing left in the tank. And you shouldn't have to explain more. You really shouldn't. I think it's one of those things that some people, they really get it. And some people, they really have to learn it. Some people just have, hey man, you got that dog in them. Just got that dog. And then just know how to push it till there's nothing left. Some people, it just takes a little bit. You got to develop that dog. It's a chihuahua, you know. And you gotta beef that little guy up. You got to upgrade from a chihuahua to a pit bull. And it just takes practice. It just takes practice. So stay after it. Keep grinding and push and push and push and push until you learn how to truly train with full intensity. It's a big kind of wrap up and all of that. Intensity is king. Use progressive overload. So just progress your movements. Do your best to get stronger. And the other piece is just don't get too caught up in all these fancy terminologies and stuff that you hear. There's application in a lot of these like very science-based approaches to training. But as a beginner, just don't worry about it. Just train. You're going to get so many gains just from training because your body's not used to the stimulus. Once you're further down the road in training, you can figure out how to incorporate different intensity methods. There's tons of different stuff that you can do to get better, to go from that plateau of post-newbie gains, and you're trying to figure out how to continue growing, that's when you add the intensity methods. That's when you dig a little bit deeper. That's whenever you play with reps in reserve and you do all these things. Even that being said, some people still get too caught up in that. Just train fucking hard, man. Just train hard. It's really not that complicated. It's not. A lot of people overcomplicate it. Totally unnecessary too, though. That's the biggest thing. Training is absolutely king. If you want to see your body change, give training everything that you have. Fall in love with it. If you don't love it, you're not going to stick with it. And if you want to see change, it doesn't happen quickly. So you got to fall in love with it, and you got to push. You got to keep pushing and keep pushing and keep pushing. Stay consistent. Be a dog consistently over time. You'll see the gains come on big time. Number two. Very important number two. Some people's number one, in my opinion, not quite, but food. Food, man, it's huge. It is a huge part of what you'll do, especially if you want to be a competitive bodybuilder. It is unavoidable how you're going to have to approach the food. Now, if you're more on the side of like amateur and fitness enthusiast, you could probably, you know, live your life. You can be a little bit more lax with it, but you still need structure in your eating if you want to see progress happen. Like, you just have to. Number one thing, prioritize protein. Absolutely have to. It's got to be protein with every single meal. Every single meal. If you're going to be a bodybuilder, hey, get used to eating 5 times a day to start. Some people get 6. But you're going to have to eat all day. And you're going to have to learn how to do that. You're going to have to learn how to be prepared. And you better learn how to cook. Because, man, you don't want your food to suck. It's going to be hard to eat. So, learn how to prep your food. Learn how to eat your food. And the other big piece of this, too, is adherence to a structure, right? That's just what it boils down to. As a bodybuilder, you've got to be able to hit it every day consistently. With people who are a little bit more on the amateur side, doesn't matter, dude. You got to do that too. You got to do the same thing. Chicken and rice. And I don't need to say much more. Eat chicken and rice. It works. It works. Super easy to digest. Gives you everything you need. Hit it with a little bit of olive oil. So you get your carbs, you get your fats, you get your protein right there. You know, eat your greens, eat your fruits. Have some colors in there. But hey, man, eat chicken and rice. Eat beef and rice. Eat some high-quality red meats. You know, grass-fed beef, bison, stuff like this. Great gains. Good and highly micronutrient-dense sources of protein there. Don't start crunching protein shakes. Okay, you're not going to drink 4, 5, 6 shakes a day and get huge, man. Just not. You know, protein shakes don't make you huge. It's just protein. You know, if you got it, if you're in a crunch and you got to get an extra shake in, you can't hit the chicken, you can't hit the beef immediately. Hey, man, I get it. It's fine. I've done it before. You'd rather get it than not get it. So do what you got to do. But don't crunch them. Eat your food. Eat all your food. And don't miss meals, man. Don't miss meals. Just stay extremely consistent. The other part that is applied with the food here is just the discipline that comes within the lifestyle of what it takes to eat like a bodybuilder, what it takes to eat like a person that wants to gain muscle and wants to grow in general. That's, you got to upkeep at the other parts of your life too. One is sleep. Dude, you got to get good sleep, period. If you're not getting good sleep, you're going to greatly blunt the muscle gain and the body fat loss. And you're going to, hey man, you're going to feel like shit. You ever rolled off 4 hours of sleep? Don't feel good, do you? It's for a reason. So especially when you're training hard, when you're eating a lot of food, you're expending a lot of energy, gotta get your sleep. Recovery. That's your recovery mechanism. Everybody wants to get in a nice bath and do cryotherapy and get massages. Hey man, they're all great. All of those things I'm highly supportive of. But if you're trying to do all that in replacement of getting quality sleep, you're done. Hang it up. Not going to work. Got to have your sleep. Other pieces, just these little parts of life that a lot of people, hey man, all the parties and stuff, you're going to be that guy. You're going to skip out. All right? You know, if that's what you want for your life and you want to be the party guy, hey, go do it, man. Just know unless you're in genetic super mega elite 0.00001%, you're not going to be able to party and bodybuild. You're not going to be able to drink and bodybuild either. Some people can do it on occasion. Every once in a while, I know guys that bodybuild that don't, you know, that drink on occasion. But alcohol blocks protein synthesis, dehydrates. Those are king, one and two right there. You've got to be hydrated and you've got to be synthesizing protein at a high level. That's why you need those carbohydrates all throughout the day. So you're going to actually uptake that protein and that protein can bind in the muscle. You can grow. Alcohol cuts all that from happening. So, there's a little bit of choice to be made there. What are you going to choose, man? You want to party? Go party. Go for it. But, you know, somebody else is going to be getting huge. So you want to get huge, you want to party. You got to choose. And now that being said, you know, there's some people, hey, man, every once in a while, I get it, whatever. You know, it's your birthday, it's a holiday or whatever. You know, some people can cut loose every once in a while, and it's cool, it's fine. But just know that, you know, there's probably somebody that didn't cut loose that day and they just got a little bit ahead of you. Just a little bit. Not a lot. But 1% added up over time is a lot. So think about that. Think about that. How much does it mean to you? You know, the discipline plays a very direct part with the food because you're going to be disciplined with your food too. You can't eat a bunch of bullshit all the time, man. You ain't going to be stuffing your face with, you ain't going to get the, you know, a cake and Mountain Dew diet ain't going to cut it. You know, you're going to, hey, like I said, it's going to be chicken and rice, man. You're going to be eating chicken and rice. You're going to be eating protein shakes and cream of rice and berries and, all the good stuff. You're going to be eating real food at the end of the day. You're going to be eating real food. Everybody else eating the bullshit. They're the ones that are going to feel it. hey man, you'll be out there all sliced and diced, feeling good. And all of a sudden you'll eat some bullshit and you'll be like, wow, I feel bad. You realize how much your body doesn't want it. And man, you'll shut your body off to it completely. But if you keep, if you're that person that just keeps, you know, kind of steady, just dropping the bullshit in there a little bit, you know, you're not ever going to truly get averted to it. That's not saying you can't cheat. Another piece of it, yeah, you're going to have a cheat meal every once in a while, man. It's not going to kill you. Especially you're an off-season bodybuilder. You're a person that's a fitness enthusiast, whatever. You don't have no shows or no photo shoots or anything like that coming up soon. Dude, enjoy some food. Go have a cheat meal. But you got to be consistent is the point. You got to be consistent. You got to be hitting the protein. You got to hit all your meals. Don't miss meals. Eat your protein. Quality carbs. Quality fats. Bang. There's your recipe for success. Skip the parties. You know, alcohol out. And come on, do I even got to say it? Recreational drugs and stuff. Yeah. You ain't going to be sipping lean getting fucking huge, dog. It's not how it works. Yeah. Drink your water. You got to be hydrated. That's another piece of it, too, especially whenever it comes to training, is there's some great evidence for training even slightly dehydrated compared to full hydration. The performance difference is exceptional. You got to be hydrated. Drink your water. Just drink a lot. Everybody's like, how much water should I drink? If you want to be really specific about it, probably 1 ounce per pound of lean mass on your body. Now, that means you got to calculate your lean mass. You don't got to do all that. Just drink a gallon. You know, if you're a normal human being, you're not like some 6'6", 300-pound monster, drinking a gallon is going to be fine. That'll be plenty. So do that. Drink a gallon. You know, get over a little gallon, that's great, but get there.
Numero tres. Number three. The next most important part is the mental game, man. We talked about it early in the podcast. How to control your mind. It's huge, all right? To give you a little personal anecdote, I'm like in my third year of off season right now, okay? Does it suck? Yeah, it does. Yep. I got to the heaviest I'd ever been a couple weeks ago. I was like 221 before bed, 222 before bed. I'm not tall, okay? If you know me and you've seen me in person, and you know, 221, it's not okay. I don't feel good. All right. Well, and that's the first time I've been that heavy too. And yeah, it felt like it's the heaviest I've ever been. It sucks. All right. But then I get to these modes of being like, I'm laying in bed at night, right? I'm trying to go to sleep. I'm like, sweating, just feeling like a lard. All right. Spilling out of my shirts and my pants. Oh, dude, I just feel my pants just squeezing my muffin top, and I'm just spilling over the top of my pants, and my belt hurts. Has your belt ever hurt? You know? Dude. The point is, sometimes this stuff can suck, all right? If you want to be great, if you really want to be a great bodybuilder, it's going to suck sometimes, because you're going to get there and you're going to get on the other end of the spectrum too, where you're going to be starving, shrink wrapped in your own body, skin laid over muscle, and that's all you got. You're hungry. You're going to get to the primal point of starvation, and you'll be some of the only people in the population to do it. If you get in shape, if you get in real shape, because most people don't. Especially on amateur levels, dude. If you look at pro bodybuilders and guys that have elite level conditioning, those guys have that dog in them at a different level. Y'all are not the same, okay? Some amateur bodybuilder, dude, you could be 280 pounds. You could be huge. And you don't get shrink wrap conditioned. You ain't got that dog in you. You do not have that dog. I guess some things maybe they go wrong, a little bit wrong in prep for some people. And maybe you could have got there, but you didn't. Maybe you had bad guidance. In that case, get you a coach that knows how to get people in shape. If you're at every one point in your prep and you're thinking, man, are my calories too low? Am I going to look big enough? You should have put more size on in the off season. You should have got bigger then. You know, you think about, oh, my calories, oh, my coach cut my calories again. Am I going to look big enough on stage? Hey, no offense, but you're probably not big enough in the first place. The other piece is, that's just for most people, right? On the amateur level, they're probably not big enough in the first place. The other piece is to get that level of condition, you got to go to a dark place in your head. To get to that place in the off season where you're getting really big, you got to go to a dark place in your head. And here's the thing, man, I didn't get to the size that I've gotten by eating a bunch of bullshit either, man. It's 400 grams of rice a meal. 500 grams of rice a meal. If y'all don't know, the volume of the cooked volume of that is like 4 cups of rice, of cooked rice. And then your oils and then your chicken or your beef or whatever it is. It's mentally hard. This is pretty specific to new bodybuilders. Now, if you're one of, a fitness enthusiast, a person that wants to get big too, hey, you're going to have to get to some uncomfortable places. The difference is there's kind of a sliding scale of where the bodybuilder might be zero whenever they're trying, you know, zero whenever they're trying to get absolutely shredded, but they're 100 whenever they're trying to get, you know, some size on and they're like peak bulk time frame. You're probably going to be more like 20-80, right? But 50 is comfortable. So you just fall somewhere on the same scale. You're going to have that same level of mental strength to get to those uncomfortable places. It's just what it takes, man. It's just what it takes. It's brutal. But you have to come back to the same principle at the end of the day. It's going to suck. But guess what? You're choosing this. This is what you're choosing. So, hey, it's a privilege. It is a privilege that you get to. People, you know, there's people all across the world that would beg to have even just a slightest bit of freedom in their day-to-day life, much less have the ability to choose to be a bodybuilder, you know? So if that's what you want to do, man, be ready to be uncomfortable. Be ready to have big, chunky, lethargic off seasons, and be ready to, you know, get really, really uncomfortable in preps and get absolutely shredded. You're going to have zero energy. You're going to have zero. You have nothing left. Whenever I say you're going to get the primal level of hunger, I mean that. You're going to get to a full nutritional depletion level of hunger that your day-to-day person will never get to experience because they're in the gastric dumping level of hunger, as in there's nothing left in their stomach. Their body signals their brain and goes, hey, I'm hungry. So guess what? They go eat. That's not going to be you, dog. You're going to eat something. It's going to be such a small meal that you're still going to be hungry and your body's going to keep burning body fat way before your next meal. And then you're going to eat that meal. It's going to be so small that you're still hungry and that hunger is going to compound all day. And guess what? That's the life you chose. So remember that. It's all a privilege to do. And it's what you choose to do in the first place. So be grateful for it. If you choose to do it, don't bitch about it. You can vent, you know, everyone needs to get it off their chest sometimes to your loved one, significant other, whatever it might be. You got to get it off your chest sometimes. Lay there, oh, this sucks, you know. Sometimes you got to wallow in it a little bit. But, hey, man, don't broadcast that stuff. Don't go up to every single one of your coworkers and your friends and, oh, I'm so hungry. Fucking quit then. Do something else, you know. It's not fun. It's not fun all the time. But you're not doing it for fun, are you? You're doing it to get huge. You're doing it to be a great body, but whatever it is, you're doing it to get shredded. You're doing it to get huge. Neither one of those processes are comfortable. So be ready for that. Next important tip. This one is probably a little bit harder to do. And it's going to take more time. But learn your body, man. You got to learn it. How many guys come up to me, I can't gain weight. Oh, I eat so much food, I can't gain weight. You can't? You sure? Because here's an idea. Eat more. You got to figure it out, man. I was that kid where I was coming up and I was like, I realized it was hard for me to gain weight. And then I started stuffing myself till I was sick. And guess what? Gain weight. I don't suggest that. But you need to find out how to eat more food. And I'm so sorry to tell you that it's a very simple answer. Don't be a bitch. All right? Being a bitch. If you're saying, I can't gain, yes, you can, dude. It's a metabolic process. It's numbers. You're spitting out and burning, expending a certain amount of calories every single day. Eat more than that. That's how you gain weight. And same thing with losing body fat, you know? And to be completely honest, what's funny is I haven't heard it from that demographic nearly as much. I've heard some of it. I've personal trained, you know, I've probably been in front of, at this point, hundreds and hundreds of people who are looking to further their goals and fitness in general. A lot of them being overweight people. Most people in the overweight category have come to me and said, you know, hey, man, I got to change. I got to put the fork down and I got to exercise, you know. I like ice cream. I like Chick-fil-A. Whatever, right? But usually they're pretty quick to admit that because, you know, they know they're not going to fool anybody. You know, you don't get to that point without, hey, just eating some shit you shouldn't have and eating a lot of it. But I have had a very small piece of that demographic come to me and be like, I don't know why I'm not losing weight. I don't eat that much, you know. I'm like, they probably don't. They probably don't eat that much. Their metabolism shut down. But when they do eat, they're so hungry, they start binge eating. They're probably eating a lot more than they realize, you know. But it happens. There's a demographic of especially young men that I meet that hit me with that all the time. They hit me with that, I can't gain weight. Yeah, well, say you can't. So you're never going to get big. Sorry. It's where you're at forever. You've learned your body. You can't gain weight, right? Learn your body. Do you burn body fat quickly? Do you pick it up quickly? Do you gain size quickly? Do you not gain size quickly? Figure out where you fit. You know, I think the old endomorph, ectomorph, mesomorph categorization of the human body is a little archaic, but it does have some application. Because, you know, it's yet again, it's one of those things, there's a bit of a scale with it, right? You're going to have some people that are more endomorphic, but they lean to mesomorphic somewhat. And you have people more ectomorphic that lean towards mesomorphic as well, somewhat, right? Somewhere in between. You're going to fall in between somewhere on the scale is the point. For me, you might look at me now and might find it hard to believe that I have a really hard time putting on size. But like I said, man, I've been training for eight years. And I haven't really missed meals. I haven't really missed training in 8 years. I've been at this for a long time. So, I'm still young. But like I started when I was young. So, you know, it's just taking grind, man. And it's taking consistency and being consistent over 8 years. There's some people that can be consistent for 3 or 4 years and probably get double the results that I do. But the point is that these people fall somewhere on the scale. And for me, I burn body fat, boom, crazy quick. Whenever I start to get lean, my muscle gets hard and dense and striated. And I get very lean very easily. Picking up weight, dude, I force feed. I absolutely slog through meals sometimes. I've sat in front of my meals for, you can attest to this, 45 minutes, an hour sometimes, sitting in front of my meals in the off season, just spoonful after spoonful of, you guessed it, chicken and rice. So, do that. Do what you got to do. And if you're opposite of me and you pick up body fat and size really quickly, whenever it's time to cut, you're going to have to get to deeper, darker places, man. You're going to have to do more cardio
than the guy that burns body fat quickly. You're going to have to eat less food than the guy that burns body fat quickly. The point is that you can hit each point on the scale. You just got to figure out which one you are. I'm the burn body fat quickly, pick up size and fat a little bit slower type guy. I'm fortunate that I think I pick up size quickly enough. I'm very responsive to certain things. So I do pick up size pretty quickly on a, like, relative to most likely. You know, I'm there are people that are that pick up size a lot quicker than I do, but I'm hard pressed to think that there's a lot of people that burn body fat quicker than I do. You know, realize what your advantages are, man. For a person like me that burns body fat really quickly, guess what? I got to push for longer. So I'm in this year three of off season. Hey man, you got to get huge. That's a piece of bodybuilding. You got to be huge. You can't just be big. You can't just be pretty big. You can't just be look like a guy that works out. You got to be huge, man. So it takes pushing. And for me, it's taking a lot of food, a lot of pushing. So you might be like me. If that's the case, eat more, eat a lot, get uncomfortable. Sucks. Go through it though. Earn your stripes. You know, if you want to look like a monster up there, you got to earn it. And then same thing with guys on the other end of the spectrum. If you want to look if you look absolutely crispy, shredded, striated glutes, hard lines, feathered quads, you want all that, gonna have to eat less, gonna have to do more cardio. You'll probably have to start prep sooner than most of those guys too. So keep that in mind. Learn your body. Learn what it likes, learn what it does. The same thing with food and training. Like, you got to know what type of training your body likes. You got to know what type of food your body likes. There might be something that screws your stomach up. Don't eat it. Eat stuff that makes you feel good, digests easily. With the training, do stuff that you like doing and do it consistently over a long period of time, because then you're going to stick with it big time. Right? You do stuff you hate all the time, or at least you choose to hate it. I used to hate a back squat. It's my favorite thing in the world now. I loved back squat because I learned to love it. You know, I fought through it enough so many times, back squatting, hating it, until I was like, you know what? You know, I own this exercise now. And it started feeling good. So, hey, man, do what you know works for your body, but you got to find it first. My suggestion, it always goes back to the same thing. I obviously coach people, right? So I'm a huge believer in coaching. I always say hire somebody, but I buy in myself, man. I've hired somebody to allocate these things for me too. So whenever I say hire somebody, I believe in it. I invest in it myself. Okay. It is my job as well, but I invest in the same thing myself. I wouldn't do it as a job if I didn't believe in it. So hire somebody, get all the kinks worked out. You'll learn your body faster if you're working with somebody who knows what they're doing. Now, if you can't afford it, if it's not something that you're ready for, whatever it might be, you want to figure it out on your own, do it, but got to figure out eventually which one you are. Okay. Lastly, what we're going to talk about, and I've got to start by saying this, and after I say it, you already know where I'm going with it. I'm not a doctor. I'm not telling you to do anything. I am advising you against it. If anything, it's purely, one, for entertainment, two, for harm reduction purpose. We're talking PEDs. The D in PEDs stands for drugs. Talking about drugs, performance enhancing drugs. Okay. So suggestion number one, don't do them. Don't do any drugs ever. Okay. That's my first suggestion as a newcoming bodybuilder, especially newcoming fitness enthusiast. You want to be an influencer, whatever, right? Don't do drugs, dude. Not worth it. Not worth it. It is going to cost you a lot of money by way of, one, buying them, two, getting blood work done consistently to make sure your health is in check. Three, if you're doing PEDs, and you can probably push more food, you're going to cost more than food. Your cost ceiling gets way higher when you're doing drugs, man. So my suggestion is do not do them. If you are a new bodybuilder, especially if you're a young dude, hey man, just fucking, but just bodybuild.
Just eat, train hard, sleep, do all that. Do all that first. Now, that being said, as a competitive bodybuilder, if you want to be high level, you're going to have to take some form of PEDs. My suggestions based around this, purely opinion based. I have studied this stuff for a very long time, and I would highly, highly, highly suggest against usage for anybody at any point. If you want to be a competitive bodybuilder, you already know that it's a part of the game. Whenever you make that decision to take some form of PED, here it goes back to the same point. One, dude, hey, man, you better have someone really intelligent in your corner who knows pharmacology. You need to have a very good and well-informed coach. I have seen some death cycles. I have seen some stuff that I'm like, hey, man, you're lucky to make it out of the backside of that. So don't just listen to anybody. So if you do choose to dabble as you want to be a competitive or highly competitive bodybuilder, you better have someone intelligent in your corner. You better be getting blood work a lot. And, you know, the person who's riding your cycle better know what they're doing, man. Don't go get drug advice from your buddy. Look at your coach. Look at who he works with. Look at who mentors him. Look at his pedigree. Look at the athletes he puts on stage. I'm saying he, she, either, right? Look at the person, the athletes they put on stage, and what type of camp they're in. That's a big deal to me. There's a reason I work with the coaches I do. I know who's associated with. And those people don't screw around. They know what they're doing. They're high level at what they do. I want that, you know? Like, I want somebody who is organized and intelligent and approaches these things in a methodical way. So you need to do the same. I'm not kidding when I say this. If you haven't heard anything I said about drugs, listen. If you do it wrong, you're gonna die. So take that shit seriously, man. You'll literally kill yourself. Like, no joke. There's a reason you see bodybuilders that drop dead. There's a reason you see that at high levels too. If you do it wrong, you don't stay on top of your health, you don't get yourself checked out, you don't invest the extra money in health supplements and all these little things that you think are nuances that maybe you can pinch a penny on and not do, dude, you're missing the point. And hey, you shouldn't be bodybuilding in the first place. So, you know, that's my opinion on it. One, don't do it. Just don't do drugs, okay? So many people chase instant gratification. It doesn't exist. Even if you're on gear, you're not going to get instantly big. You still have to train like an animal. You still have to eat all the food. So you still got to bodybuild. You still got to do the same exact thing. You just stack that on top of it, and it's going to accelerate the process. You're probably going to get a crazier look. No doubt. But if the origins of you loving to train and not complaining about putting down ample amount of food consistently, if that's you, and you know, you desire to be a pro or a high level bodybuilder of some type, and you choose that lifestyle, hire somebody who knows what they're doing. If you don't hire somebody who knows what they're doing, you better read and read and read and read. Like, there's tons of published medical journals, case studies that exist for a lot of these PEDs. You know, most all of these PEDs that are floating out there right now. I'm not including SARMs because those aren't even, I wouldn't even consider PEDs. They are, They're made for animals, okay? So we're going to exclude those. I mean, AAS, anabolic androgenic steroids, they're studied. Look at the case studies. Look at the evidence. Look at everything that backs them. And then, you know, study that. And if you feel like you have a full academic understanding of it and you want to bypass the coaching part, I can't stop you. I would still suggest having somebody I would still suggest having somebody for a second set of eyes to make sure that they're monitoring everything. Everything is moving along as smoothly as possible. Some people get horrific side effects, life-ruining side effects. All right? Be ready for the risks. Understand them fully. To wrap up, man, don't do them. And if you're going to do them, no one's going to tell you no. No one's going to stop you. You better do it right. And if you're going to do them, and you do a show, and you show up out of shape, I'm gonna be pissed. All right. Why would you do drugs? Show up out of shape. I was talking about that the other day, and I'm not judging. I guess I am judging. Maybe I am. I don't give a shit. Look, if you're bodybuilding, dude, and you show up out of shape once, I get it. I did. I get it. You know, I was 19. I don't know. I nationally qualified, so I did great. Look back on it, people probably think I was in shape. I wasn't in shape, dude. I wasn't in stage shape. If you're a grown-ass man, and I see you continuing to compete and compete and compete, and you're out of shape every single time, and I know you're on drugs, you show up out of shape, you come out of the backside of it, you make some post about how proud you are of yourself, and then you go binge eat, you've got the whole process ass backwards, and you must love to lose, because that's got to be the most unhealthy cycle of... That's what to me signifies drug addiction. You're addicted to the drugs. You don't bodybuild because you want to be a bodybuilder. You're addicted to drugs. You want to do drugs and you want to binge eat. So you diet hard for 8 weeks. Cheat here and there. Show up out of shape. Lose. Tell yourself you worked really hard through an Instagram post. And then go slam ice creams or whatever the hell. You know, that's cringe, dude. Just juiced up to the gills for what? For what? To me, bodybuilding is very much like a sacred thing. Yeah, you push your body to extremes. But that's the point, isn't it? And now if you show up absolutely dialed in shape, shredded to the bone, maybe you're not the biggest guy in the world, but you're shredded, you went through it, you went through the process, and you get beat. Ah, dude, okay. Is what it is. I'm proud of that. I like seeing that. I like to see that. I see guys that get in gnarly shape and they'll, you know, they lose contests. Hey man, is what it is. Back to the drawing board. It's the guys that show up out of shape and they're on drugs and then they lose and then they pat themselves on the back and then they binge eat. Most of these guys are trainers and coaches too. Oh, anyway. Quick little pet peeve I'm going to throw in there. We were talking about pet peeves last week. There's one of mine. Don't be that guy. Keith did great today. Man, I don't know if I named this little fern yet. Carlton, maybe. Carlton the fern. Keith and Carlton. I like that. Carlton the fern. Keith the cactus. My boy Stanley. Done great today. Isabel. Excellent too. Isabel's behind the scenes. Just been you know, really reacting. I haven't really had anything to fact check or look up. She was there for it, though. So, yeah, got to respect that, you know. Thank you for watching and listening. Quite a ranty episode. And, hey, man, that's what I'm all about. Next week's going to be fun. I'm going to hop on with Jonathan. We're going to talk a good bit. For guys that don't know, you know, I'll obviously introduce him, but Jonathan Hambrick, he is a IFBB pro, classic physique, two-time Olympian, and a big, strong bastard. I've had some of the most fun I've ever had training with Jonathan. Really looking forward to chopping it up with him. So that'll be next week. We're going to record on Sunday, or release on Thursday. Like I said, thanks for watching. If you got anything from the video whatsoever, I really, really hope you did. But if you did at all, share it in the comments, man. Let me know what you think. Drop one of those thumbs up, hit the like button, subscribe to the channel, and you know what to do, bro. Turn on that little notification bell so you get a little ding from your boy every time we drop a video. Thank you for watching, gang. Appreciate it. We're gonna be back next Thursday. You know what to do, SEANCAST.